All right, good morning, everybody. Call to order the regularly scheduled Board of Supervisors meeting for this Tuesday, March 13, 2018. For me, as weird as this sounds, this is a day that ranks right up there with Thanksgiving, Christmas, and the 4th of July. This is the day we get to set our budget. And you've got several people laughing out there, but there's a lot of truth. The reason I ran for supervisor 10 years ago and the reason I'm sitting here today is our primary reason is I'm really interested in the way the county budgets and how we manage our money. We're excited to present what is, I believe, another outstanding budget, and we'll get to that when we get to public hearing. But first, as always, let's honor America with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, again, good morning. First item, as always, is public comment number one. There's an opportunity for members of the public to comment on items either on today's agenda or not on today's agenda. Really anything anybody would like to comment on. We've got Brenda Dreyer, who's going to come up and I think give us an update on Story County's unemployment rate.
Good morning, Brenda.
Good morning.
Brenda.
Happy Budget Day.
Love Budget Day.
So we've been anxiously awaiting the new unemployment numbers for the month of January, which normally we're about a month delay in getting actual updates on where we're at with unemployment. You might remember we ended 2017 the lowest MSA in the country at 1.4%. And we're just really anxious to see how that trend would continue into 2018. So the state actually does some benchmarking and kind of settling of itself after the first of the year. So it takes 2 months to get January numbers. Those arrived yesterday. So we actually ticked up to 1.8% for the month ending January 31st. The interesting thing to note is that we're hanging out at 1.8%, and the nearest counties to us are at 2.3%. So there's a cluster up in northwest Iowa that actually tends to be pretty low as well. But they're actually at 2.3, so we're substantially lower than anywhere else in the state of Iowa. Interesting to note is Marshall County also went up from where they were at the end of the year, and they're up to 6.8%. I honestly don't remember any time here of late where we had a county really above 5%, and to have one substantially above that and a whole 5 points higher than we are, and actually as a neighbor is very interesting. So,
and you actually did a job fair in Marshall County.
We did. And we have alerted, specifically I copied Supervisor Chitty on that, alerted our Nevada employers. I think they have a real opportunity to maximize that, as well as some of our larger employers in Ames. Of that, and our offices are going to be developing an appropriate strategy to launch some advertising efforts into Marshall County. But I thought it would be of interest to everyone to see kind of where we're at in relationship to others in the state of Iowa, in relationship to the central Iowa region. And we'll continue to keep you posted as we move ahead into 2018.
Super. Brenda, thanks so much. Appreciate the job you do. And Morgan, I mean, that's basically full employment that we've got in Story County. So thank you. Anybody else wishing to address the board on any topic at this point? Okay, agency reports. First, we got the Volunteer Center annual report. Ann, who said she saw two big fat robins sitting on a branch as you left. That's a sure sign of spring, isn't it?
That's what I found.
All right, good.
It's a lot easier to do that than cleaning up a whole lot of crap. So thank you very much for your time today. Thank you again for the continued support Story County continues to show the Volunteer Center of Story County. 2016-17 year ending last year, where we are currently, the Volunteer Center is for the third year on a row, and we are on track for the fourth year in a row to add an additional 2,000 mobilize an additional new 2,000 volunteers. Most of the folks we mobilize through our events are just that, new volunteers to either the partner agencies we refer to, which we have now broken 100, and we are at 192 partner agencies that utilize our services, if nothing else, more as a means of being out in the World Wide Web, that we work with volunteers, as well as for our support in training and helping them support and manage and engage their volunteers in their own programs. So we're very excited about the growth. We continue to see an increase in requests for service and supportive service from Iowa State. We are seeing an increase in area employers looking for support for workplace volunteer programs, offering incentives and volunteering opportunities as a benefit to them, to themselves as a company and as employees. To date, 2,500 hours to date have been served by volunteers, and that's before we head into April and the summer, which has several large volunteer opportunities. April is Volunteer Appreciation Month, so we have our longest day of service coming up on April 7th, when we stash the trash for the 18th year in a row. We're anticipating mobilizing 250 to 300 volunteers. It could be more because it coincides with the end of Great Week, and as well as being spring, people wanting to get out in the community. We know in April we'll be mobilizing an additional 400 volunteers through Nevada High School. They're doing their annual day of service for the third year. Collins Maxwell did one in the fall and is looking at doing one in the spring for mobilizing high school volunteers. A lot of those events, when they happen, we work closely with the educators and the students, coordinating those to help them find ideas and work out some of those logistics on projects. So it's an incredibly exciting time for service. It's an incredibly challenging time for the Volunteer Center, and it's incredibly challenging for the staff at the Volunteer Center, which is myself, to keep up with all of that. So I greatly do appreciate the investment Story County makes, and I like touching at the end of my report. Just to date, with half of our asset funding being drawn down, the hours that have been served by mobilized volunteers, those volunteer impacts generates a $34 return that Story County gets. And that's just on 6 months.
Yeah, I mean, anytime we can invest $1, one public dollar, to get 34 back in service, that's astounding.
Exactly.
Thank you for your work.
And we're very happy to do it with the high unemployment. Volunteering is a great way for employees to gain skills, work on their skill development, distinguish themselves in employment opportunities. 2 years ago, research showed that 27% of people with just a high school degree people with just a high school degree who volunteer are 27% more likely to find employment than those who don't. And one last shameless plug, if you haven't done so already, April 3rd is the National Day of Recognition of Service. I don't have those words quite right in the right order. For the Corporation for National Community Service, and we're asking elected officials, local officials, Story County and city officials to sign on their support for national service like the Senior Corps and Central Iowa RSVP and service programs like we do. So I'll be sure to send you that link.
Yeah, get that to us. Please do, so that we can. So one of the things that makes Story County such a special place is how active our citizens are. And I view the work that you do as the conduit that allows so many who want to be active to really find that place where they can make a difference, and we're just so appreciative to the
energy. That's exactly what we try to do. Thank you very much.
That's right. Marty, any questions?
I see what you do through the knothole of my community here today, that knowing what the administration has done to generate the Silver Cord hours and the day of service, and it comes in a benefit to another organization here in town, our historical society, that you take these future citizens and show them the value of their time, and then their efforts kind of self-perpetuate, and it's been a very good thing. You had said that you were looking to put another office into the campus town area. Is that
it is a dream of us to have a satellite office specifically on campus or in campus town to specifically focus on coordinating service. Silver Cord, as you mentioned, is almost every school district but one in Story County has a Silver Cord program. So those high school students are developing that habit of service early on, and they want to vote. And as the research bears it out, the sooner you start, the longer you keep at it. So with the increasing student enrollment at Iowa State, more students want to volunteer and fill their time constructively. Faculty are incorporating service into the course studies and coordinating that 36 to 50,000 just on within Story County, the surrounding area, would, is in our mind, be of benefit to have a satellite office dedicated even 1 or 2 days a week for that. So we really hope to, but we've got some negotiating to
do. I suspect you're on to an untapped resource there on campus, so I wish you well on this one.
Thank you.
Okay, and thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Next is LSI, agency report.
Morning, Alyssa.
Alyssa, how are you today?
Okay, how are you?
Outstanding.
So my name is Alyssa Russ, and I am a service coordinator for LSI's Early Childhood Program. So our programs include parent development classes that families can take, parents with teachers, which is a community service, and then what Story County funds us is our Crisis Child Care Program. The Crisis Child Care Program, we are able to be on call 24/7 through 65 for those families living in Story County that are in a crisis, have a child between the ages of 0 and 12. So they can call us at any time to partner with in-home registered daycare providers. So they're getting background checks done, DHS is going to their homes, we have safe environments. We also do our own personal checks on our providers that we partner with. And then when a family calls us, we can establish what the crisis is and place those families' children for up to 72 hours. Does it mean they have to use all 72 hours? We have some families maybe that just need a couple hours here and there. Sometimes we'll have to extend it depending on the crisis, or they might use a couple hours.
This service is provided by freeconferencecall.com. Please enter your access
code
and phone.
So last year, we served about, through the whole fiscal year, 25 unduplicated families. This year, we're up to 15 unduplicated families. Last year, we were able to serve 51 unduplicated kids, and this year, we're up to 30. So with our numbers, or the remaining between last year and this year, we're going to hit about the same numbers and not go a little bit over, just depending when the weather starts warming up. A lot more things seem to happen. So far this year, we're at 935.5 crisis hours that we've done just in Story County. A crisis can include anything from domestic violence situations, homelessness. We've seen a lot of medical emergencies this year, with a lot of single parents who don't have anybody else. Or just regular parental stress. We've had a couple court cases this year. We've also been able to start partnering with legal aid. So if a family is in a crisis and has to maybe get somebody legal aid, not the most appropriate things to do for children, so we can help out in those instances. The only thing we can't use our services for is backup child care. So if a person's provider calls and says they can't call us, we have a lot of people do that, but just explain our program and then go from there. We've also been able to try to do more outreach in our rural areas, so trying to partner with local police departments, fire stations, schools. It's really great that this program can serve all the way up to 12, because a lot of our other programs only go up to 5, so then the schools really aren't a huge resource to us, because by the time they're in school, we can't serve them anymore, so we're going to one of those programs that serve up to 12, so we can partner with those different agencies as well.
Super. Again, a vital service that unfortunately we need from time to time. We're so appreciative to you for providing. Marty, Anna?
I, as you have too, served on a DCAP board, and Alyssa comes and speaks to us. And just for everybody's edification, why don't you touch on what you tell the DCAP board in regards to infant and small child care in Story County?
Yeah, so right now, one of the biggest things we're seeing with crisis child care is, again, the families calling us that don't have care. We're seeing a huge decline in available child care spots in Story County. So that happens to be one of our challenges, is that we partner with those registered in-home daycare providers. Well, they have specific rules that they have to follow with how many kids they can take at any given time. And right now, with the lack of child care in Story County, they're full. So we've actually had to turn away 6 families in Story County because we haven't had space for them, because our providers are full.
obviously that's unfortunate. We don't like doing that just because we don't know what's happening in those situations, especially if we don't get to follow up with a family, whether it's the phone number changes or they move out of the area. We still try to follow up with them if we can, but that's something that we've really been struggling with, is trying to find providers that have open spots. Especially once a spot comes available, somebody is pretty quick to get in there and take it. I know a lot of infant spots right now are on your wait list.
Oh, yeah.
So unfortunately, it's kind of odd because most services, daytime hours are where they thrive. Our hours happen to be nights and weekends because that's when they're not providing care for their typical kids.
Right.
So we can use our services, so we're kind of the opposite to it.
It's an interesting story, and it always fascinates me to see the numbers that you say are out there waiting. Because you have made mention of, you know, dozens into the hundreds, virtually, that as people come to our county that they have needs, and as we encourage people to come join us in Story County, that this is one of the deficiencies we have, and if anybody was looking to start a business, this would probably be a good place to go.
Yes,
definite market there.
If you want to be an in-home registered daycare provider, now is the time. They'll love it instantly.
Well, thank you so much.
Yes,
thank you, Alyssa.
Have a great day.
Right.
Yeah. Oh, good. Well, Supervisor Olson is joining us from getting ready to get on a cruise ship here in a day or so. So thanks for joining us, Loris. In order to keep this as smooth as possible, Loris, we'll have Barney and I make the motions in the seconds, and then you just weigh in whenever you need to weigh in. We're to consideration of minutes for both February 27th and then our limited agenda on March 6th. Do I have a motion?
I so move that we move consideration of the minutes for those 2 minutes.
Second, anything we need to note? All right, Chitty.
Aye.
Sanders. Aye. Olson.
Aye.
Absolutely. Consideration of personnel action as listed?
So moved.
Second, any discussion? Chitty.
Aye.
Sanders. Aye. Olson.
Aye.
Consent agenda.
As presented.
Second. Chitty.
Aye.
Sanders. Aye. Olson.
Aye.
That leads us to public hearing items. And the reason for my excitement today is it's like a little birthday party. Let's start with introductions. First, our elected officials. I see County Attorney Jessica Reynolds down front. Lucy Martin, auditor, headed to the microphone. I know I saw Stacy Herridge, recorder, back in the back. I think that's all the elected officials, department heads, Deb Shildroth, who is Director of External Operations, Jerry Moore, Planning and Development, Sue McCaskey from Animal Control, Darren Boone, County Engineer, Joby, I lost it, Joby.
Brogdon. Facilities Management.
Yeah, that's right. Joby Brogdon, Facilities Manager. The last name I couldn't remember. Mike Cox from Conservation. Brett McClain from Veterans Affairs. Carla Webb from Community Services. Leanne Harder, Special Projects and Community Outreach.
I think that's it.
Oh, Barb. Barb from IT is with us. Outstanding.
Morning, Barb.
Did I get everybody? That's hard to do. Okay, and then the one and only, Lisa Markley, who's the best in the business and gonna provide us the budget information that everybody works so hard to put together.
So welcome to the public hearing on the FY19 budget. This proposal was published in all three officials' newspapers on March 1st as required by law. Today's budget, adopt it as published, or you can lower it at this public hearing. Those are your only two options. There are handouts available up here to include some of these charts, along with the proposed projected FY19 salaries of department heads and elected officials, which does include a salary increase. This whole presentation, along with the handouts, is also available on the website for anyone interested. Our process starts in December with evaluation reports. Story County did see a slight valuation increase this year. For countywide, it was 6.6%, and for rural, it was 2.8%, which I think Rick and I both were convinced it wasn't going to be an increase in rural, but it was. The rollbacks is the rollback is the amount that the property is taxed on. So if you own a residential home assessed at $100,000, that taxable value for the upcoming year will be $55,621. For agricultural property, the taxable value will be $54,400. Commercial and industrial is rolled back to 90% and backfilled by the state. At this point in our budget, we put in 100% backfill. However, this is one of the credits to local governments that's being discussed at the state level to discontinue the funding.
And that amount is 700?
$745,000. Half of that, about $295,000, affects the general and supplemental funds.
Okay.
If it's 100, that's the 100%. I don't know what the conversation is at this point in time, but I think they're talking about a 3-year phase in. The multi-residential is rolled back to 78.75%. This is the third year that that's rolled back, and it has the most impact in Ames, obviously, because these include apartment buildings that were formerly classified as commercial, that they weren't rolled back at that point, but now they are. Our departmental work sessions were held in early January. The audio for those are on the website for anybody that's interested in listening to those. They're in this budget. There are salary adjustments. All 5 bargaining units are supposed to have a 3-year settlement for 2, 2, and 2, I think, in the contracts. And there's also varying pay matrices in those. 2% cost of living adjustment for all non-union. And the health insurance premiums were budgeted at 15%. I think Alyssa came and said that was, at this point in time, we aren't sure what those are going to be.
We're starting to feel better about it.
Okay, good.
Yep.
Good. Our asset.
I tell you, before we go on from salary, just so everybody's clear, so the 2% for bargaining units and 2% for our non-bargaining unit employees, that's more of a cost of living. I mean, it's not directly a cost of living, but that's the increase that everybody gets. There are other increases depending on what bargaining unit you're in, how long you've been serving. They're called step increases that come along with it. The reality is the effective rate of raises for the average Story County employee is going to be somewhere right around 4%. That doesn't mean every employee is going to get 4%. It means that all said and done, when you average it all out, we're going to be somewhere in that 4% range across the board.
In this year's budget, there was an increase to ASSET, which stands for Analysis Social Services Evaluation Team, of 6.25%. Capital Improvement Plan is going to be at next week's board meeting, not at today's. And that includes funding for secondary roads and equipment, Hickory Grove Beach House, Cabin at Dakins Lake, ISU Research Park Work, Prairie Rail Trail Expansion at Dakins, and the Animal Control Building. That's actually in the current year and in next year, because we're not sure when that's all going to happen. We also continued our economic development funding for urban renewal, small communities, and home-based Iowa. The departments continue the goal of budgeting as close to actual as possible, and overall the goal is to match revenues to expenses without a significant use of fund balances, which is what the definition of a balanced budget is. The revenues in this budget are $274,963 higher than the expenses.
And let's just stop right there and say every single one of our elected officials and department heads, without exception, did a phenomenal job presenting an initial budget that really made our job much easier this year than it has been in the past in terms of figuring out where we can have some savings and what we can put together. I just can't say enough about how prepared everybody was when they came in, and that they all bought into that goal that we had put forward, which is really, really try hard to toe the line.
So I want to talk a little bit about the different levying funds that the county has the ability to levy for. I'm going to talk about what the code and limits and requirements are for these. Countywide is the maximum is $3.50 per $1,000 of taxable value. That means every county or every taxpayer in the county pays on this. The supplemental also is countywide. It is limited to certain mandated services, which are listed up there. and it cannot be accessed unless we're at the maximum on the general fund. This year, the supplemental levy is increasing slightly. It's by $346,000. It's going from 91 cents $1,000 to 93 cents, so it's a two cent increase, mainly because of insurance cost increases. The county MHDS fund, the maximum levy is calculated in a totally different manner than any other levy.
Per capita.
I have to get that in.
The
rate is capped per region based on the population of that region. For our region, the per capita limit is $35.50, which for Story County translates to $3,446,000. The region recommended a levy of $2,155,000 from Story County, which in turn is a levy, which is how we make our how we do our budgets, of 47 cents, and that's down from 50 cents in the current year.
And let's just be really, really clear here, because everybody needs to pay attention to this. So right now what's happening with our region is they've got a large ending fund balance. It was in the neighborhood of $18 million. I would imagine they're just below that now. And so the state has mandated that every region spend that down to about 25%, depending on the size of the county. So we got a falsely low levy going right now. Story County is kicking in just over $2 million, but really we should be kicking in $3.4 million. So this is artificially low right now, and if the state does not really start to figure out how we're going to fund mental health for the long haul, the people of Story County better be aware that our levies are going to go up in terms of mental health in the next 3 or 4 years as soon as that ending fund balance is spent down. And it will have a dramatic impact on our budget.
At the fiscal meetings that we've had, the finance committees had, we've talked about being back in the cycle of up and down, up and down, up and down, because again, this is the only fund that the legislature says you can only have this percent ending fund balance,
right?
Or we penalize you. So, you know, we're back in that cycle that we were in 10 years ago or 5 years ago with the levy rate going up and down.
Well, and you add to that, 100% right, Lisa, but you add to that this fictitious way of arriving at a dollar amount, which is per capita rather than by levy rate. Everything else, we're limited either by levy rate or what we're allowed to spend money on. This is the only one that is set based on how many people are deemed to be in Story County. And there's huge problems. I'm gonna spend just a second to advocate for a proposal that's down at the State House. Has been there for 3 years. I think it'll be there for another year or two, but hopefully we can get it done, and that is the increase of our sales tax by 1 cent. 3/8 of a cent would go to the I Will program. 3/8 of a cent would go to fund mental health, which would remove this levy. So it'd be a savings of $3.4 million to the people of Story County in terms of potential levy, if we can get that through, and it would finally consistently fund our mental health services in a reliable way. Go ahead.
Or get on my soapbox and say, let's just do this levy away with you the rest of them.
Yep.
The debt service levy is on countywide. Everybody in the county pays that. It's a per $1,000 evaluation. This year it's 16 cents per thousand. That is for the refinance secondary road bond, which pays off in FY19.
You mean it's paid off, we'll be completely out of debt if we don't borrow any more money,
right?
In terms of GEO.
GEO, correct. Yep. And the rural limit is $3.95. That's on unincorporated areas only. The maximum for that is $3.95 per thousand. This budget is putting together, or this budget has $3.18 per thousand. Overall, we're lowering our tax askings, or we're raising our tax askings in this budget by 1.3, but the levy rate is going down by 2 cents, and still the lowest levy since the 2000-2001 Story County budget.
Which, amazingly enough, is when we built the Justice Center.
Amazingly enough, that's
it goes together. So it's down, in my 8 years here, it's down from, what was $5.82? I think the first time I sat down here, we're down to, what, 506 now in the countywide.
So the counties are required to budget by service area for revenues and expenditures, which we go through the whole budget process by department, and then I have to put it all together, and then it comes in by service area. So let me just go through what the service areas are and where our revenues are. We're budgeting for a little over $40 million in revenues this year. 63% is coming from property taxes. 22% is coming from intergovernmental, which includes our road use tax, our state replacement taxes, including the commercial and industrial replacement, any state and federal grants. 6% comes from local option sales tax, 6% from fees for services. 2% of our revenues come from TIF revenue, and 1% is from interest in revenues. Our budgeted expenditures in this budget are $39.8 million. This is a pie chart of where those services actually are budgeted by service area, or where those dollars are budgeted by service area. 31% of our budget is for public safety and legal, which those are the services included in the sheriff and the attorney's offices. 17% of our budget is going to roads and transportation, which is obviously secondary roads.
So just point out, 50 cents of every dollar, 49 cents of every dollar goes either to public safety or secondary roads.
Right. 15% of our budget is classified as administration. In that, it would include all the facilities management for the buildings, information technology, the board of supervisors, the county liability insurance, and the auditor and the treasurer's management services. 10% of our budget is for county environment and education. That funds conservation, animal control, planning and development, IRBM, and county libraries and urban renewal projects. 9% of this year's expenses are for capital projects. We have road construction, TIP projects, and CIP projects in that. 6% represents health and social services. Out of our health and social services, we pay for environmental health, community services, VA, juvenile court, DHS local office, and many of the asset services. 5% of our money, or 5% of our dollars go to mental health services, which is local and regional. So we send almost all of those dollars that we levy for mental health to the region. 4% of our budget is for bonded debt service payments. 3% is for governmental services, which includes the auditor's election side and the treasurer's motor vehicle services. This represents 6 years of the budget and expenses and where they're funded. We talked about ending fund balances earlier and where we wanted those to be. We based that on our expenses by fund. The general supplemental are the primary operating funds and has the largest overall expenses. And the majority of those revenues come in September and March with property tax collections. Our financial policy is to budget a 25% ending fund balance. This proposed budget actually reflects 30%. The regionalization of mental health has impacted the MHDS fund, and the expenditures at the local level have dropped substantially. The dollars levied in this fund are all sent to the region. The rural and secondary roads funds are fairly steady funds, so we can budget closer to 20%. I think we're 18% for the rural fund in this budget. And those funds have monthly revenues, such as local option sales tax and the road use tax. So this shows the total county budget as originally certified for the last 7 years. The dark blue, which you can't really see up here, shows budgeted expenditures, and the red is the budgeted revenues. For the FY19 budget, our expenses are 2.6 higher than our FY18 adopted budget, and the revenues are 2.6 higher than that.
And so important to note, if that chart was extended backward, you can see where the expenses finally dropped below the revenues there in FY14. But if you ran that all the way back for the last 30 years, the expenses were always higher than the revenues. In some cases, well, some cases by as much as $6.2 million, I remember off the top of my head, I think in FY10, that we had a budgeted expenditures of $6.2 million more than we had in revenues. What's important to note on that graph is, while it's really, really close, and it should be really close, the dark blue line, or the revenues, is above the light blue line, or the expenses, in every year for the last six.
This shows the current year distribution of dollars by budget by taxing authority. We will take a look on the following slide at the individual tax statement and where the dollars go, but this gives a snapshot of the overall dollars generated by taxing authorities. Of our dollars, 46% goes to the schools. The cities are next with 25%. The county gets about 17%. And then all the other authorities that have levying power are below 5%. This chart for Story County is comparable to statewide information from the United States Association of Counties. Overall, schools in the state of Iowa levy at 42%, cities at 29%, counties at 22%, and assessors at 1%. So when you come into the treasurer's office to pay your taxes, the breakdown of how those dollars are distributed is represented here. I'm really sorry you cannot see the numbers in there. It's really good on my screen, but it's not working. This year I used an Ames resident. This is based on last year's city levy rate. As their budget has not gotten certified to us yet, it comes in by 315. School budgets get certified to the auditor on 415, so that's also last year's rate. If you have a home assessed at $100,000 in the city of Ames, the taxable value would be 55.6, as we talked about earlier. And your annual taxes would be about $1,763. Of that, the school, Ames in this example, would get about 45%. The city would get 33%. The county, 16%. The area school, which is DMAC for us, is 2%. And other, which includes Ag Extension, the city assessor, and the Story County Hospital, would be about 4% of your taxes. So if you live in Franklin Township, which all the townships have their own levying ability for fire and cemeteries, and Ames School District, the pie would look like this. The total taxes would be about $1,410. School would be 57%, county at 32%, the township at 2%, the others 3 and 6.
You can find a house in Ames or Franklin Township for $100,000, let me know.
I was like, maybe I should change that and start raising that.
Makes the math easy.
But as I said, this is available on the website. This presentation is, and also there's some handouts up here. Any questions? I'm more than happy to answer them.
Marty, Loris, any questions?
No, we did a very slow walk. I appreciate the fact Loris and I are just doing your second budget. You're very accessible as far as coming to your desk, having these small conversations to lead up to these big decisions. This is a well-reasoned, well-thought-out. Rick said it earlier. I would thank every department head and every elected official coming aboard that sat before us and presented their budgets and everything they asked for had merit. And we got to write a quick resolution with very little acrimony. And I thank them.
Being a member of the Board of Supervisors is a really eclectic experience. You get to work on lots of different things. No 2 days are alike. That said, where a Board of Supervisors can and should have their greatest impact on county operations is right here, setting the county budget and then managing that budget throughout. This is, if you want to know the true goals and aspirations of any organization, take a look first at their budget and then see how they really spend their money. That will tell you all you need to know about any organization, and I think Story County is in a really positive light, not only in how we budget, but then how we'll manage this budget throughout the year. Lisa, another great job. Always appreciate you so much, and because I think Marty and Loris, there was a noticeable difference this year. So last year was the first time that either Marty or Loris had dug into a Story County budget. And this year, there was such great give and take between the three of us. I've already mentioned that our elected official and department heads were outstanding, but we had some really in-depth, almost minutia kind of conversations to make sure that everybody understood how the dollars relate to each other, what's an appropriate expenditure, and why we're deeming to do what we do. So the first thing we've got to do, and I guess before we get to the public hearing, is we've got to pass Resolution 1885, which sets elected official salaries. The recommendation from the Compensation Board, so those of you that don't know, the Compensation Board is made up of seven citizens in Story County. Each elected official outside the Board of Supervisors gets to appoint a representative, so that's five, and then the three Board of Supervisors get to elect two representatives, so that's the seven individuals. They met in January and had a really, really good discussion about where to go, and their proposed increase was 3% for every elected official. And that would be the actual increase. So I told you earlier that we have 2% in cost of living for our employees, but that's not a true actual for our employees. It's going to depend on what bargaining unit you're part of, or whether you're merit-based or step increases. This 3% would be the true and total increase for our elected officials. So, discussion on Resolution 1885.
I thought it was, you know, we have a good fortune, and I think the elected officials take it upon themselves to bring some very wise and capable minds to the Compensation Board. They have a very reasoned and widespread depth of knowledge where it's a fascinating. If you want to come to one of the most interesting budgeting components of what we were talking about doing here today, I would say the Compensation Board would be something I would encourage our citizens to take part in, because you learn a lot as they bring various perspectives from their individual domains. And I thought it was a well-reasoned, I thought it was a reasonable approach. I find it acceptable, and I'm inclined to take it up. I would throw this at Boris, our colleague, as she spoke the year before, but she didn't this year. And Boris, what do you think?
I'm comfortable with the approach they use, the reason they use, and the percentage factor that they use this year.
Super. Marty, would you make a motion?
And I would move approval of 1885 as recommended by the Compensation Board.
And I'll second. Further discussion? Chi.
Aye.
Sanders. Aye. Olson.
Aye.
It passes. So now, we'll go to the public hearing. Please give your name and address if you wish to speak, we'll move through this as rapidly as we can. So with that, public hearing is open. Anybody wishing to speak to the proposed county budget, please come on up to the microphone. Okay, seeing no one moving to the microphone, we'll close the public hearing. And I will turn to the board for action on Resolution 1886, the FY19 budget.
I would move adoption of Resolution 1886 as published for our FY19 budget.
And I'll second.
Wait.
Oh.
You have not answered the question.
Marty's got to read his script.
Certified taxes as published, which includes assignment of the funds as follows: amount in the general fund for specific purposes, amount in the rural fund as unallocated local sales option tax at 40%, capital projects fund as assigned for animal control, building remodel, and to direct the auditor to properly certify and file the budget and certificate of taxes.
And I will second that. Good job, Marty. Discussion. Hearing no discussion. Chitty.
Aye.
Sanders. Aye. Olson.
Aye.
Budget passes. That's it for public hearing items. Thank you, everybody. Lisa, Lucy, great job as always. Elected officials and department heads, thank you guys so much for being here. You're welcome to stay for the rest of this if you'd like. We're two additional items. So these are items, these next few items that we're talking about are items that were presented to us as part of our FY19 budget conversation. As we went through and looked at not only our FY19 budget, but where we stand in FY18, the board suggested and conservation agreed that we would go ahead and move some of the items requested for 19 that we felt good about up and go ahead and purchase them in 18. So the first one of those is the purchase of a trailer for conservation for $2,895. Mike Cox, what are you using the trailer for?
Well, you pretty much covered everything. The trailer is for work days, out and about, to haul supplies out for volunteer work days, for our trail projects, community service projects, service learning, I should say, projects, etc. So it would be a nice addition that we can keep equipment used for those in the trailer and haul it out as need be for those service projects.
And you requested bids from three different locations. This was the lowest lowest price quote that came back to you.
Correct.
Discussion?
None.
Make the motion.
I would move approval of the purchase of the trailer for conservation from Thomas Bus Sales for $2,895.
And I'll second. Further discussion? Chitty?
Aye.
Sanders? Aye. Olson? We might have lost Loris. Let's see. Next is consideration for a truck and trade-in for conservation from Carl Chevrolet for $35,484. This is a replacement vehicle.
Correct. It's a replacement for one of our fleet vehicles. No surprises here. Normal replacement for a heavy-duty truck that we use for operations.
If you got anything, if not, make a motion.
No, please. I had moved approval to purchase a truck and in the trade-in for conservation from Carl Chevrolet for $35,484.
And I'll second. Chitty?
Aye.
Sanders? Aye. Next is...
I'm
on
aye, too.
Okay. Oh, you're back. Good. And Olson?
I'm still here. Sorry. Yeah.
Okay. Next is discussion and consideration of purchase of trail step materials for Story County Conservation, $4,377.05.
This was out of McFarland, right?
Correct. Another item that that was discussed in FY19 brought forward. This is just the materials in order to do that. Then we'll have volunteers help with that, and probably have a youth service crew help with that as well.
Sure. And let's just explain to everybody what's going on here. So one of the ways that Story County over the last half dozen years has managed its budget and tried to keep from having peaks and valleys. So the one chart that we saw earlier showed everything fairly flat, right, on the expenditure side. We try to keep our expenditures as flat as possible. And one of the ways we manage that is we get to this point in our fiscal year. So when we were talking about this, we were 7 months into our fiscal year, and you've got an idea of how everything's going for that year. And so if you can find a way to utilize existing dollars to make future purchases, right? So you're in essence pulling it away from asking the people of Story County paying taxes on it into we're doing it out of savings from this year. It's a way to manage that expense line item and keep things as flat as possible. That's what's going on here. Now, specifically these trail steps, these are steps that you want to do out at McFarland. You put it in the FY19 budget. We talked about, hey, is it reasonable to go ahead and get that done in this fiscal year? You took a look at it and decided it was. That's how we got here on this item.
Correct.
Any discussion?
None.
All right.
I move approval to purchase trail stem materials for Story County Conservation for $4,377.05.
And I'll second. Chief?
Aye.
Sanders? Aye. Olson?
Aye.
And then finally, consideration of purchase of a UTV.
Correct. Again, normal replacement.
Right.
This is for one that we have in the fleet at Hickory Grove Park, and it's at the end of its life. So again, normal replacement of this UTV with a trade-in. Mm-hmm.
And this is a 10-year-old UTV that we're replacing, and we have really gotten our good out of it.
So it's a new gator for an old gator.
Yep.
New gator for an old gator. Yeah.
All right.
I would move approval to purchase a UTV for Story County Conservation for Manual Equipment for $13,400.
Second. Chitty?
Aye.
Sanders? Aye. Olson?
Aye.
All right. Thanks, Mike.
Thank you, Mike.
Discussion and consideration of Orion domain name service for $10 a month fee, Mark Steinbeck, who I forgot to introduce earlier today. I know. I get going and I lose track of where I am in the room. Mark, how you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Good. Tell me what we're buying from Orion.
Well, this is, if you remember, during our budget meeting, we talked about the Windstream circuit and how we're going to downsize that. Windstream handles our DNS right now, so in order to discontinue the circuit, we need to move that DNS. So we're moving it to Orion, who's our phone vendor, and the $10 a month is similar to what we paid Windstream. We'll be doing that later this week after we finish our current project. So all it is when you type in storycounty.com, this DNS service translates it to an IP address so that it goes to the correct server and so that you're routed correctly. So that's all it does. It's a service that we need. One thing that I will point out, once the changes are made, it's not instant because it has to propagate to all the different servers that you bounce to before you reach your destination. So it may take a couple days. And so that's why the email went out this morning that our email will be affected by that. So anything coming in may be delayed. Anything going out is fine.
Okay. Questions? All right. Take a motion.
Move approval of the RN domain name services for $10 a month as proposed.
And I'll second. Chidi?
Aye.
Sanders? Aye. Olson?
Aye.
Thanks.
I will point out there will be a third document. You've got two in front of you. The third one lists the IP addresses, which are the current ones. By the end of the week, that may change. And then that's the confidential piece of it.
Good. Thank you. Thanks, Barb. Next is discussion and consideration of bid tabs. And we're doing three here, I think, aren't we, Darren? These are bids that we opened 2 weeks ago, and just remind us all what these all are for as we're going through it. The first one is Project LF20A 7385, and this is West 190th resurfacing.
Correct. We had two bidders. The low bidder was Manats. They were considerably lower than our estimate, but I do want to point out this one's a bit unique. That West 190th was originally graded with a mortar grader and just seal coated, so it doesn't have the cross slope accuracy our normal roads do. So when you overlay a project, it's going to make up for all those deficiencies in the cross slope. So it will overrun, and we're expecting it. That's why it's that much slower than the rest. But I expect to be somewhat closer to the estimate by the time all said and done.
Okay. And the estimate was 252, and the bid came in at 216. And you expect us to end up at 252 or thereabouts, but you are recommending that we go ahead and award the bid to Manats for $216,000.
Correct.
Questions or a motion?
I appreciate it. I was kind of surprised to see it was that far on your estimates. You guys are usually pretty close to being spot on. I knew there was a rationale, and now I've heard it. I have comfort in approving the bid tabulation for Manats Inc. at $216,680.58.
And I'll second, and just a reminder, this is for the West 190th resurfacing out there by Prairie Moon is what we're talking about. Chief?
Aye.
Sanders? Aye. Olson?
Aye.
Next is Project L-L13-73-85, 120th Street Bridge Replacement.
Again, pleased with the low number from Herberger, but I did want to point out the wide variation in the bridge. The past few years have had a lot of wide variations in the cost of the bridge, so it's hard to estimate. But this one came in considerably lower than our estimate, which is great, but the next one you can see is $100,000 more. So
right.
Why? I don't know that's happening lately, but it is. But I'm pleased with Herberger's bid, so I recommend Herberger to award contract.
Nothing else I need.
Okay.
I move approval of the bid tabulation for Herberger Construction at $316,164.90 for the 120th Street Bridge replacement.
And I'll second. Chief?
Aye.
Sanders? Aye. Olson?
Aye.
And then finally is Project LC2B-73-85. And LLIN5-7385. These are culvert replacements.
again, working with PCI the past few years and getting really good prices from them, and again this year. So I recommend PCI, recommend award bid to them. They were $45,000 less than our estimate.
And we got multiple bids on this. We had six different bidders on this one, so we feel really secure where we got it. We know Peterson does great work for us.
Yes.
Marty, anything or a motion?
Move approval of a bid tabulation from Peterson Contracting Incorporated for $318,391.10 for the bridge replacement culvert as listed.
And I'll second. Chi.
Aye.
Sanders. Aye. Olson.
Aye.
Outstanding. Thanks, Darren.
Thank you, Darren.
Next is discussion consideration of proposed Ames Urban Fringe Plan Map Amendment request from Chuck Twinkleblack, who is representing Clara Wadoff and Martha Jean Nordyke.
Morning, Jared.
This is the first step in a process to take a look at this so that everybody knows where we're talking about as you pull that up. We're over on County Line Road in West Ames. Or just west of Ames, kind of not to Cameron School Road, but going north right there.
Great. We're about 3/4 of a mile north of the Ames corporate limits. We're in West Ames on the east side of North 500th Avenue. And again, as you stated, Rick, this is the first step in the process. It requires two of the three entities to decide whether or not an application should be submitted. Would it be Story County, Gilbert, and the City of Ames? The City of Ames has already supported the request to submit the application. There's actually two parcels. One's 41 acres, the other to the south. They're contiguous, is 33 acres. Currently zoned A1 district. They both have natural areas going through the center portion of them. The north parcel is mostly designated natural area. I think probably not exactly designated correctly.
Right.
A third of it's in ag, row crop production. The south parcel is natural areas as well as urban residential district. And with the urban residential district designation, the policies state that before there's any development, it should occur, first of all, it should be annexed, and it should develop under the city standards, whether it's Gilbert or the city of Ames.
And there's no plans by Ames to annex out here.
There is no plans. In fact, there's been discussion with the Ames Planning and Housing staff, and they do support a request to change the designation on both of these properties. The applicant is actually working with someone who is interested in acquiring both properties, and their plan is to take that 75-acre area, two separate parcels, and have a total of four separate lots for four single-family dwellings. So again, this is where we're located. West Ames, about 3/4 of a mile north of the corporate limits. We're on the east side of North 500th Avenue. As I said, there's a creek, a treed area that extends through the central portion. Again, this is the first step in the process. The City of Ames did support the request on January 23. We did send notices last week. We did get some response. The Iowa State University had some questions about what was being requested, questions about the process. The main point that they shared with us is they want to make sure that people who are acquiring these properties know that they're there. They're about a half mile to the east on North Dakota Avenue. We also received an email today from a property owner that's within a 1/4 of a mile to the south, and basically stating they're not supporting a larger scale residential development.
Sure.
This person indicated that it was their understanding that there would be more than four divisions on this two parcel area, and that's what's being requested. So I think we're on the same page of what's being.
They're just concerned that you're talking about a big subdivision coming in.
I think that's part of it. They also expressed concerns about the wildlife ecosystem,
sure,
concerns about traffic, light, and sound. But again, if this is supported by the board, that would make a majority of the three. The applicant would need to go to the City of Ames to actually submit the application, and then likely it would come to the Planning and Zoning Commission, Story County, and the board in April, possibly in May.
Yeah, and so let's just be clear what was so. First step in the process, just to consider doing something like this, but what's being requested ultimately is to take a place where you could build two homes and be able to build four homes.
Correct.
Is what ultimately is being requested here.
Right. And today, we've done property research on both these properties, and each one of those parcels is buildable for one single-family home.
Right.
But to get to where they're requesting, they cannot do that under the current names of the French Plan designation.
Which is why the map change would be necessary. All right. So pretty, in my mind anyway, pretty straightforward that this is just a request for us to look at it. It's not a request that we say, yes, you can do it. Should be pretty cut and dry that we would send this on to let planning and zoning take a look.
You'll receive the application with the details likely and possibly May.
Marty, any questions?
No, I appreciate the outreach that was done by Charity's office back to Mr. Winkleblack. Because there's quite a bit of crosstalk. People don't realize what happens in regards to what seems like a very straightforward process. And I don't know how many hours have you ever tried to keep track of that, but I suspect that there's a few here.
We spent a lot of time actually working on the Ames River Fringe Plan request and information. I also want to add, too, before I came up here, there was a property owner to the south who had questions about it. And I think after I explained what was being requested, what the board was actually looking at today, that sufficed. For today, but I think this person's going to keep track of the actual scenario.
As they should. I mean, but you look just to the south of this property, there's three homes right there that are basically similar in terms of having multiple acres. I mean, all of these are going to be 15 plus acres if it ever gets approved, and there'd be some commonality.
Right.
So, okay. If there's nothing further, I'd take a motion, Marty.
With that, I would move to approve the application as submitted. To the proposed Ames Urban Fringe Plan Amendment application to the City of Ames. And I thank Jerry for his time and his staff's time.
Outstanding. Second, further discussion. Chitty.
Aye.
Sanders. Aye. Olson.
Aye.
Great. Thank you, Jerry.
Thank you, Jerry.
To departmental reports, and again, Barb's not back today. Tell us what's going on in IT. There's a rumor we're going to have a new website here before long, Barb.
I think I heard that rumor as well. I really appreciate how fast the board meeting is going today. I was afraid I could be here at 1 o'clock and would say come back next week.
We're moving.
Yes, we are. So I would like to open with a little update on our website refresh. We have finally found a common ground in the splash page, the initial page you go to. I think you'll like it. You offered some suggestions the last time when we were almost there. So the new design looks really nice, so I think you'll be pleased. I believe that is a surprise.
Mm-hmm.
We figured out our navigation, the broad base of the navigation. We'll be able to make small changes, but it's the framework that we've approved. And now we're moving to the training stage, which will take place the last week in March. So I've sent out emails to all the department heads asking which modules they feel are more important. So the 4 days we'll be training, they'll offer the different modules at different times so that everybody can participate. So I'd like to move on to some networking updates. We spoke a little bit earlier about the Windstream circuit. I did submit an email. I talked to our rep and submitted an email per his request stating our intention to not continue our contract for the 20 meg circuit between here and the Justice Center. And then we also have a PRI that has our fax numbers on it. So we'll keep that. But the DNS ran on our 20 meg circuit. So just in case things weren't ready for the April 9th deadline, I've asked that after April 9th, we go month to month with the caveat that we could cancel at any time. So I think we're good there. And I've also talked about the DNS move, the course switch. This week we're working with a vendor on, as you know, last fiscal year we finished our core switch replacement. However, there was one path that has been giving us trouble, and that's between here and the Justice Center. So they're here to figure out what's wrong with configuration, why doesn't it work. And I must point out, we do have a new network administrator. It's not his fault. The problem is, when you have a network this old and you make changes every year, to make all those changes happen in 1 week that have happened in the last 10, 15 years is really difficult. And there's not a lot of documentation on this, and we've added some things. So it's taking some head scratching, but I'm confident we'll get that finished this week so that we will be ready then to disable that 20 meg circuit from Windstream. I also wanted just to talk a little bit about animal control, with all the updates and things that are going on there. There's been a request that maybe now we can get them on the phone system, and maybe can give them access to our file server. So we've been looking at some different connection options. We got a quote from Windstream for a dedicated T1. We asked another vendor for actual digging of fiber, $125,000 there. But then we've also been working with a vendor from Southwest Iowa who's offering a radio solution, which is kind of interesting, at a cost of $15,000 total with a 5-year maintenance built in. So I think that might be the direction we're heading. Now, this is just speculation at this point. We're just kind of looking at what's out there, but we've never been thought of looking at radio before, so it's exciting. So just wanted to give you a heads up on that. I'm going to talk a little bit about some issues with the multi-agency. I don't usually talk a lot about this. The multi-agency is made up of City of Ames, Story County, and ISU. And we meet the first Wednesday of every month and discuss different software issues, hardware issues, things that are going on right now. One of the things we're talking about is the VINE program, which is victim notification. Right now it's an FTP site and victims can go to that site and get email or text messages when the perpetrator pertaining to their crime has been released. So what APRIS, which is the vendor for VINE, would like to do is make this a secure FTP site. So at our last meeting, it was kind of a lot of tension brought up because no progress had been made on this. So we finally got all the vendors together and found out they'd never done it before. And they're rolling it out to a target group this week. So we're going to wait and see how that goes before we make that change. Basically, all it is a firewall change. You open up the port. We want to make sure that there's not issues with the software if we do so. Another thing that we've been struggling with is this 28E agreement, which I believe was initiated in 2005. And that involves the three agencies as well. And we're struggling with that because it is very outdated and a lot of the security has changed. And we've got some outer agencies that want to become part of our radio group and part of the software. And we don't have anything in that 2080 agreement that addresses this. So getting people together to review the agreement and make the changes has been a struggle. We're still talking about it 2 years later, after we first decided it needed some changes. So I'm not sure what direction we're gonna go with that, but I just wanted to bring that to your attention that this is something that needs to be done and we just can't find a way to do it. And yes, part of that.
Barb, is the discomfort something just you see here on the county side, or is there anything expressed from the other two parties at all?
Everyone is struggling with it. Everyone agrees it needs change. And the people that attend the meetings are the users of the software, the people in the PSAPs, the networking people, the IT folks, that help from the Ames Police heads it up. So everyone understands there's a struggle, but we don't know quite how to deal with it. And part of that struggle is my next bullet point is the purchasing roadblocks that we run into. And we had this when we needed to replace the firewalls last year. So what happens is every year at budget time, we get some figures from Ames as to what we need to contribute to the multi-agency budget, our third, and every year it goes up. But what's built into that is our hardware replacement costs. So every year we contribute toward hardware replacement that happens every 5 to 7 years, and then the software costs and the licensing costs. And so there is money in the budget to buy new servers, which are now 7 years old.
Need to be replaced. They're at the end of their life cycle.
Yes, and we've been working on some quotes for over 6 months now, and our struggle is we can't get them approved because the purchasing piece of that falls with the City of Ames, and the City of Ames purchasing agent right now won't sign off on them unless he feels he has enough justification. So the IT director from Ames has reached out to me asking for some input into the justification, which since we purchased the servers initially from the same vendor that we got the quote from this time, they're calling us sole source. And so he wants to have justification for that. I provided my comments and my opinions. It was also the lowest quote and the quote that met the standards that we were looking for, so I'm not sure what the delay is, but there is a 90-day lead time on ordering. Once these servers are ordered, there's a 90-day lead time, and we've got the dispatch consoles, we've got software updates, we've got some projects here. They're all hinging on that, so it's backing us all up. Just wanted to know if you had any suggestions or any way that maybe we could, and I know you don't have a lot of background other than what I've told you.
So we just purchased new consoles from the Sheriff's Department for an budget of $80,000, but last meeting or the meeting before.
Yep.
And so this pushes back against that purchase,
yes,
for not having new servers that
right
would be used in conjunction with that. Is there somebody we need to talk to over means?
My feeling would be it would, with your approval, that this would be something that would fall to the chair to go visit with the city manager of Ames, and if Barney, you and Loris agree to that, then Barb, I'd just ask you to give me all the information I need to go have that conversation with City Manager Schenker.
I would think that, yes, I have no qualms with doing that if that's something you want to bring back to us next week, as far as an action.
Yeah, I don't know if Steve's even in the office right now, but I would get in to see him as quick as I possibly could. Loris, you're good with that?
I'm fine with that. Thank you.
Yeah. So, Barb, give me the information. I'll get a meeting scheduled with City Manager Schenker as soon as possible and get over and have this conversation and just see if we can come to some sort of resolution.
That sounds good. I had asked why the purchasing wasn't addressed in the 2080 agreement, and someone mentioned it's because we're not counting ourselves as a separate entity, which is why we can't have our own purchasing agreement. But as the sheriff pointed out, that's a third of our money too, and we can't spend it because we're being held up. So I will get you that information. I appreciate you looking into this.
Sure.
Taking into account what she, just to stop you right there, considering that how old the 2080 is, and she says that there's discomfort from all three parties, maybe that would be part of your conversation with Mr. Schenker.
Sure.
Appreciate
Loris, you got anything on that?
No, I agree. I think that Ripple handled it well and brings back all the issues that we need to look at.
All right.
Wonderful. Thank you. Also, as part of that, the security agreement needs to be redone. It's totally outdated. And then, as I mentioned before, the other agencies want to join, but we have nothing for them to sign. We don't know how we're going to support them. So all this needs to be addressed. It seems like it all goes back to that agreement. So hopefully that's something we can get resolved soon. And we are, by the way, since we have grown substantially since this organization was, this group, this committee was formed, we are looking at a vendor to provide support for the 911 network and the software. So that's something we're meeting with them next week. We may have some information on that for the next time I report. Also, I just wanted to point out, we're doing some IT orientation, and we're kind of piggybacking on the onboarding. What we've done in the past, when a new user comes into the county, we have set them up and given all the credentials to the manager of that department. Sometimes it doesn't get passed along, sometimes the manager's not there or forgets. So what we've come up with is a checklist. And once we thought, well, what all do they need to know? So we came up with this large checklist. They need their Windows username and password. They need to know what the password policy is. They need to know how to place help desk tickets. They need to know what the on-call policy is, the intranet login and review. They need to make sure, we need to make sure they understand Section 4 of the acceptable use policy. We need to show them how to use their phone instead of their voicemail. We need to give them a LightEdge spam account, show them how to log into webmail, training on the S drive. So we created this checklist. We thought, oh wow, so we're gonna be part of the onboarding. When they come to facilities to get their new badge and everything, they'll just stop over at IT and we'll go over this checklist with them and have them sign it and make sure that they know what to do. And if we were looking at some of the videos that Noelle showed, and it is true, a lot of times they set the person at the desk and say, hey, there you go. And if they don't even know how to contact IT, where do they start? So I'm really excited about that. It's something we've wanted to do for a while. So we've got
good
that in place.
Outstanding.
The only other thing I wanted to update you on, some of the have it listed under software updates. It's the Jail Helper program that we got a quote on, and the work has been completed to review the software. Different items were pointed out. The group over at the Sheriff's Office that has been working on this has fixed most of the issues. We still have three major security issues that need fixed, so they're going to give us a quote to fix them. They also, the vendor also sent us a quote to support the software and have us out of it. It was delivered back to the jail because they wanted to make some changes for an upcoming review that they have as far as inmate time in and time out. Michael wanted to have something on his software that would calculate that before the jail review. So anyway.
Help me remember the amount we spent to fix this particular program last year.
We didn't fix it, we reviewed it and pointed out all the problems for $21,000. So the problems were listed. Josh and Ben took it upon themselves. They fixed a lot of the problems, but there were three that they couldn't. One includes encryption of data at rest. And then there was some header information and some other things. So there's three outstanding things that need to be fixed. They sent us a quote for $5,000 to fix those. And then if they were to provide ongoing support, they're calculating maybe 10 hours a month at $21,000 a year.
Who's they?
This would be the vendor, the ACS vendor that we chose for this.
Okay. So it'd be outside of Story County?
Yes.
Okay.
So I'm just updating on this. I'm not sure, but it probably needs a separate discussion.
Yeah, it needs a separate discussion. Once we get to the end and you have a recommendation. Yeah.
So that's where we're at. Any questions for me?
No more questions.
Mark, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
And look at that, we got you out of here by 11:15. You thought you were going to be here all day.
I'm surprised and happy.
You are. No other reports today. That brings us to public forum number two, opportunity for members of the public to comment on anything they'd like to comment on. We can't take any action at this point due to the requirements of the open meetings law, but we might take action in the future. Anybody wishing to address us on any topic? Seeing no one moving the microphone, liaison assignments, committee meeting updates. Loris, how's the weather?
It's only 55 degrees right now, so you'd be happy to know that I'm not as warm as I expected, but I hear you guys have snow, so I'm not depressed to be here today.
Yeah, but it's supposed to be 60 here tomorrow.
You guys have a great week, okay?
You have a great week. Have fun on the cruise and try to keep your feet as dry as possible.
All right,
party.
We had the adoption of the assessor's budget last Wednesday night, and it was both a well-attended process and a well-discussed process. I thought the mayors and the schools had the opportunity to weigh in a way that there was a lot of crosstalk, and I think a lot of knowledge was shared. Several city council meetings here attended during last night. Nothing major came out of that. Colo City Council doing some follow-up in regards to an item I'll be bringing to the board next week to discuss the joint study that we would like to have done on their lagoon system in the hopes that we could attach the Hickory Grove septic system to it. Been filling up my free time with Granite 5 meetings on a small basis. Got two official meetings here on Wednesday and Friday, and we have a very big drainage district meeting here in this room on next Wednesday night. And last but not least, I will be conducting I will be conducting a swearing in of Chairman Sanders here, who was appointed by Governor Reynolds to our mental health task force after this meeting. So if anybody wants to stick around and see something quite
interesting. Yeah, that would be really exciting. Outstanding. So last week I got to attend on our behalf National Association of Counties meeting, and what it underscores for me every time I go to one of those is how lucky we all are to be in Story County. Lots and lots of places are trying to get where we are in so many ways, but a really, really good trip, good 4 days of meetings. It was really, really good to be back in Ames. If there's nothing further, I take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
And I'll second. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
We're adjourned. Thank you, everybody.